What I hope is that by explaining all this, people will become more conscious of their own inhibition, because a lot of people are not really conscious about why they don't write, and they just have some internal fear. And maybe they get over it and they can manage to take the risk of writing something. Fear of self-expression. Over the years, I have created different chats in different languages. And a phenomenon I've noticed is that the majority of people on these chats don't express themselves, right? I would say there's not even 10% of the people who express themselves. So now maybe some people don't really look at the chat, fine. So we can, let's see, even if we eliminate those people, still, there are people that read, and I discover through some other mean that they actually follow, read, but they don't express themselves. They don't write. So I try to figure out why. I talk to some of these silent people to find out what's going on, why they don't express themselves. And now I would like to make a little list of those reasons that I discovered to make people conscious, or maybe to overcome those different problems, and hoping they will contribute a little bit more to our discussions. First one is, my mind is empty. I have nothing to say. Well, here I have to say that's impossible, right? You cannot have an empty mind. To have an empty mind is a big task. In the East, some people try to make this as an exercise. It's very difficult because there's always things crossing your mind, even if you don't want it, right? So I would say it's just a bad habit of being passive, of a passive mind, where actually you have a permanent mental flux of associative thinking, some chaotic ideas that follow one another, a permanent movement of uncontrolled ideas, right? But people, because they don't look at it, they're not conscious of it, they have the impression their mind is passive, and they say, I have nothing to say. People who are more conscious already, they say, my mind is chaotic. That would be the second reason. And then actually they're indecisive. There are lots of ideas in their mind who come about quickly, very diverse, and they don't know which idea to seize, to hold on, and to express as soon as they would like to do that. Another idea comes. And so it's very chaotic in their mind, yeah. Third reason is, I will be criticized. Now, for some people, to be criticized is absolutely horrible. Probably they're in pain, they have a bad self-conception, they criticize themselves a lot already, and they don't want to add to their self-criticism, the criticism of someone else. So they're very allergic to criticism. For them, it's an unbearable phenomenon. They get upset, they get into fights, so they prefer, you know, not to say anything, because they don't want to take the risk of being criticized. And of course, a human being easily criticizes ideas of other people because it's not theirs. So if you don't want to be criticized, you simply don't dialogue. The fourth one is a bit the same, but there is an emotional issue as well, which is, I don't want to be attacked. Some people, they see that some get angry and that, and they're terrified at people who get upset and angry, irritated, yeah. Even when it's for the others, you know, it makes them nervous. Yeah, they say, it makes me nervous. And so they fear very much to be attacked, to suffer the anger or the irritation of other people. So they don't want to take the risk. You know, they're very fearful of any kind of a conflict, even though in writing, even if you have conflict, big deal. Not much can happen, but they're sensitive, yeah. Fifth reason is, what I'm writing is not good enough. These people, they always see a couple of people who seem smarter or better expressing ideas. You always have, you know, a couple of people who are smarter, and they compare themselves and say, no, what I have to say is not good enough. They're obsessed with the idea of, there's a sort of a competition, and the good ones, the bad ones, and they are not in the good ones. So therefore, they don't want to show their non-goodness, their badness, so they prefer to not write, since it's not good enough, yeah. Then there are people who fear to be insignificant. They say, nobody is going to pay attention to me. Nobody is going to answer me or react to me, right? So They fear to expose the fact they're meaningless, they're insignificant. So they prefer not to say rather than to write. And nobody says anything and they say, oh my God, I'm really insignificant. Again, it just reinforces the suspicion they have of their own insignificance, and they don't want their insignificance to be confirmed. Yeah. So nobody would react when you write often. Okay. Nobody reacts. So what? That's not the purpose in itself. Yeah. Then there are people that say, I will make mistakes. Though these are the people fascinated or obsessed with perfection, with what is right, what is wrong. I say they suffer from a school trauma, because in school, the teacher said, this is right, this is wrong. And if it's wrong, you get bad grades or you get scolded or whatever. So these are fearful. They don't understand the idea that dialogue is a perspectivism. It's a multiplicity of angles of thinking. And then you have to accept that there is this multiplicity and act and play with this multiplicity. But for some reason, they have the idea of something is right, something is wrong, and they do it to others too. This is right, this is wrong. So this doesn't allow them, because they fear that they might say something wrong. Yeah. Then there's the idea of stupidity. Either I feel stupid or I look stupid, but basically it's the same. Because if you worry about looking stupid, it means you suspect that you are stupid, so you don't want other people to see it. But it's the same thing, right? It's a fear of stupidity. And it means they have a suspicion of being stupid, that they're not smart, not smart enough. Yeah, it's very common. Even if people were smart, they think they're not smart enough. It's a phantom stupidity. But anyway, so a lot of people have a problem with stupidity. Then there's the prudent and cautious people who use the motto, live happily, live hidden. Yeah, don't expose yourself to the eyes of other people, right? You'll be judged, you'll be whatever. So if you want to be happy, hide in your little corner, don't show yourself. And this way, nothing will happen. Yeah. So they don't exist in order to be happy, which is a bit of a contradiction or paradox, yeah. But that's the way they think, yeah. Hiding is the solution, yeah, even though they don't feel very good in this permanent hiding. Then there is the ridicule. People who are scared to be laughed at. For them to be laughed at is the worst thing in the world, you know. They feel ridicule. They don't know that there's a motto, at least in French, that ridicule doesn't kill, right? For them, yes, ridicule kills. You know, if you're ridiculed, that's it. You know, that's the end. You're sort of a symbolic or psychological death, you know, so they fear ridicule. Then there's something more cognitive. It's people who say, I don't find the words. You see, they have intuitions, more or less. Intuition is vague, it's an impression, but they cannot give shape they have a hard time giving shape to their intuitions, either by lack of practice or by fear or whatever. So they don't finish, they just start. They have a little intuition, but they don't do the work. They don't, you know, they don't, like a sculptor who would have an idea of a sculpture, but he just stays with the idea, he doesn't touch the stone. So they say, I don't have the words, which is a bit of a strange thing. Say, you don't speak the language, you know, but they don't have the words, yeah. Then there is the self-sabotage, right? Now, self-sabotage are either people that don't start writing, not at all, not even the first word, or they start writing, then they abandon, yeah. Or they write and then they erase what they write. No. Or again, they write, they finish, but they don't send it, you know. They sabotage it. They don't complete their gesture. They self-destroy. So yeah, they self-sabotage, yeah. And lastly, the utilitarian argument. It's useless. It's time, it's energy for nothing. There's nothing to win. It's tiring. So these are people that want to do something because it's useful, you know. They see a painting and say, what's the use? They see a flower, what's the use, right? So they're obsessed with usefulness. And of course, when you participate in a dialogue, it's true. What's the use after all, if not just the pleasure of thinking of exchanging ideas, but these people, they want to find some usefulness to their action. They suffer from what I call the vacuum cleaner syndrome. They have to be useful, otherwise they get thrown away. Yeah. So this was my little list. But here I have to specify something. I have to plead guilty in this business, because it's true that in our chats, we have criteria. We give criteria for expressing oneself. For example, if someone just throws a little half-baked idea, we say, well, should explain it. Don't take it for obvious. You should give arguments. You should, you know, complete the work. After all, we're you know, training into a thinking activity. So the fact we have some criteria, well, it's true, it inhibits and scares some people. Yeah, I see this because I go on certain sites or groups where there's no criteria. There's a lot of reaction, a lot of emojis or just little hearts, and say, oh, it's great. And, you know, then, yeah, of course, lots of people express themselves. I don't know what's the point here. Personally, I find it a bit boring and tiresome to see all these emojis, and it's great. Yeah. But okay, you know, it's true. If you just let people say whatever, then yes, they will express themselves more. Yeah. Yes. In fact, certain sites, groups, they eliminate any critical commentary. They have people that regulate that. Anything negative, either people get kicked out or they erase their post. Yeah. Because you need positive thinking. Personally, I think it's quite infantile, because critical thinking is a fundamental part of thinking, of growing up or facing the world. But, you know, but anyway, so if people feel protected, they can say anything, let's call it any nonsense. Yeah, then okay, then they'll do it, right? Okay, the problem here, I'm not really ready to just have a bunch of people just sending emojis. We'd find it quite boring, not interesting. Yeah, so if I have a choice, I prefer less people, right? And it's more thoughtful. But so what I hope is that by explaining all this, people will become more conscious of their own inhibition, because a lot of people are not really conscious about why they don't write, and they just have some internal fear. And maybe they get over it and they can manage to take the risk of writing something. So that's it for now.